Welcome back to the PHSA podcast. My name is David Bickford. I'm the pastor here at Salmon Arm. This is a very special podcast series where I'm going to be sharing with you messages from our most recent conference in Prescott, Arizona, the Beyond Limits Conference, with a theme of to preach the gospel in the regions beyond from 2 Corinthians 10:16. I'm going to share all of the sermons from this conference series, and to include Greg Mitchell, our head pastor, Joe Campbell, Richard Ruby, Tom Payne, and many, many others during this series. So I'll be sharing these with you over the next couple weeks, and I hope you really enjoy these messages. If you'd like to see these messages in a video format, you can go to prescottpottershouse.com, where all of these will be available for you to view in a video format. So without further ado, I'm going to go ahead and move on to the messages, and I hope you enjoy them. God bless.
Thank you, Pastor. Thank you. I have to admit, I love preaching. I don't care if it's 10 people, 100 people. I love to preach. Someone asked me, everybody sees me, how are you? I say, well, I'm too old to die. Amen. I'm doing okay. Praise the Lord. Tonight, Matthew 28, and my aim tonight is to launch all of you. I'm going to flip the sanctuary, put you all on the platform Friday night. There's 6 people out there watching. But I have a question. Are you living in regions beyond? Is that your heart? Your conversations? Your mind? Does that live in your spirit? What city? A nation? Maybe you've never seen it, but you've dreamed about it. Never been there, but God spoke to you, or God's stirring you, and you don't know where. Theme of the conference, the great call and the heart of the Apostle Paul, to preach the gospel in regions beyond. Further and further into the beyond. But he also said, follow me as I follow Christ. Can anyone lead you? Can anyone inspire you to that place called beyond? I want to minister tonight in living in the region beyond. Matthew 28, 19, very, very familiar, Jesus. Go therefore, make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. God, we come tonight by the Holy Ghost. Power of your word, God, your spirit permeating, saturating this Bible conference. I'm asking you, God, tonight, give me words. Words of spirit and life. God, give me words of inspiration. Stir the heart of this people, God. Shake us out of where we are to where you want us to be. I'm asking you, God, tonight, break through in a Holy Ghost powerful dimension that will shake regions beyond. In Jesus' name. Jesus said, go, one of his last words. It's so small a word, and yet so powerful. It may even seem insignificant to you. It's a small word, a word I can ignore, perhaps. I can put it on the shelf. It doesn't apply to me. Maybe it's for you or you. but not for me. It's a word we fight against. We build our case against this little word. We have all of our excuses. We rehearse them. We arrange them over and over and over again. We vote for stay. There's an old song in the 1960s. Oh, won't you stay? Won't you play this while you're at it? Is that your theme song? Your mama don't mind, your papa don't mind. Is that your favorite song? The problem, a little bit longer becomes a lifetime. It's the devil's favorite song. And you can always find someone to sing it to you. Your wife, your children, parents, friends, church, other preachers, your flesh. I remember them playing it to me in 1987, 46 years old. Connie and I had made a decision to go to Malaysia. Pastor said, you'll never have what you have again. You're 46 years old. You need to look out for your security. You're needed where you are. Malaysia's a Muslim country. Is that your song? Because there'll always be someone singing it to you. But Jesus said, Matthew 28:19, go therefore, all the nations. Mark 16, go into all the world. Does that mean anything to you tonight personally? Can he still speak to you tonight? I want you to go. Mark Olson tells the story years ago over on Roos Street. God's dealing with him about the Philippines, and he's looking at me. But in the end, he said, why can't I go? And he went. He went to the Philippines with his family. I went to Malaysia. The danger of staying is we build these borders. And borders in themselves can be a good thing in the right place. They establish ownership, safety, place of security, place of structure, order, comfort, normality, familiar. They're not evil many times, but they're so predictable. Your borders become your limitations. I know how to live here. I know how to function in this place. I know how to do this. But the danger many times, there's no demand of faith. And it becomes boring and empty. And if you're not careful, you become trapped. There's no adventure there. Depression. No challenge. You find yourself locked in the same old, same old. Preach the same old sermon. go to the same service, live on the same street, go to the same grocery store, eat at the same restaurant, drive down the same highway, have the same conversations, but it's not the region beyond. Your soul is crying out to God, I'm exhausted. Because you're held hostage to these invisible walls. Call stay. And you lose inspiration. The ministry loses that brightness, that vigor, that spirit, that passion. Because it becomes normal. Is that you tonight? Are you spiritually dying in a land called stay? Just a little bit longer. The danger, if you're not careful, that little bit becomes your life. Think of the woman with the issue of blood. 12 long years, she spent all she had on physicians. She's used up. She's exhausted. She's tried this and that. Days have become weeks, weeks, months, and months, years. One day, the Bible says in Matthew 9:21, she said to herself, oh, if I can just touch, I can't stay here any longer. If I stay here, I'm going to die. I have to go, a place she's never been before. The answer is out there. It's not here. Can you imagine the mind battles of this woman? Issue of blood, 12 years. The thought, you're crazy, lady. You're too weak to go. If you go, you'll die. You've never been out there before. The battle of what? All the what ifs. Is that you tonight in the spirit realm? The Bible said she said to herself, listen, you will always believe the story you tell yourself. Doesn't matter facts. Doesn't matter this sermon, Pastor Greg's sermon last night. Doesn't matter truth. You'll always believe what you tell yourself. If I can touch the hem of his garment, I'll be made whole. No scripture that I'm aware of to support that. No encouragement from the disciples. Jesus doesn't even know she's there. What story are you telling yourself tonight? That's the big question. Oh, she said, if I can touch the hem of his garment, I felt for virtue leave my body. Are you singing the old song, Stay? Old Testament, four leprous men, 2 Kings 7:3. Why are we sitting here till we die? And they arose at twilight to go with all the limitations, all the physical problems. They made a statement to adventure into a place they'd never been. Listen to what I'm going to say. Destiny lives on the ragged edge of regions beyond. That's where you'll find God in another dimension. This is where God lives in a personal way with you. It's where miracles are born. This is where anointing is magnified. This is where God's favor is found. Destiny lives on the ragged edge of regions beyond. You ever thought, God, what do you have for me? God, I know there's something that you have for me. God, I know there's more, but I haven't reached it. Oh, I feel it. I can taste it. Could the problem be you'll never find it where you are? It's only found in a region beyond. I believe God reserves some things that you'll only experience when by faith you move to these regions beyond. You'll never find it where you are. It's only discovered in the go. Another city, another ministry, another nation responding to the call of God, pastor planting another church when it costs you. The four leprous men I mentioned, when they went, God showed up in a dimension that they had never seen or experienced. It sounded like a mighty army. And the Syrians fled. It's when you look at the Bible, it's like it's almost built into our DNA to resist the regions beyond. That risk factor, that unknown. Look at Peter in Acts. He's had these incredible experiences with God. Mount of Transfiguration, upper room experience. He comes out and preaches Pentecost, 3,000 saved. Gate Beautiful, a lame man healed as he challenges him. Silver and gold have I none, such as I have in the name. Rise and walk. Powerful experiences. Ananias, as Pastor Ruby mentioned, speaks these words. Why has Satan filled your heart to lie, not to men, but to God? All of these powerful experiences, now it's time for regions beyond. The Gentiles, Cornelius, Peter's on the housetop praying. Look at his resistance. A vision, a sheet comes down from heaven. Heaven opens. God is speaking. Peter, take and eat. Not so, not so. And this conversation took three times. Spirit said to him, arise therefore and go. I have sent you. It's amazing. He goes with these men to the house of Cornelius. The first words of his sermon, Acts 10:28, he said to them, you know how unlawful it is for a Jewish man to keep company or go to one of another nation. What a way to begin a sermon. Amen. I really shouldn't be here. I really didn't want to come here. We don't like you. God made me come. But look what lived in this region beyond. Beyond race, beyond prejudice, all the world. I wonder what he was praying for on the housetop. I wonder, was he praying, God, God, do it again. I seen it on Pentecost. Do it again, God. And God wanted to do it again. But he couldn't do it where he was. He had to take him to a region beyond. While he's speaking these words, the Spirit of God fell on Cornelius and all his house. What's waiting for you beyond where you are? What does God have planned over the horizon? Pastor Greg mentioned last night, Pastor Mitchell, broken church, Prescott, 25, 30 people, and then hippies. What's your prayer? God, I don't want to see you move. God, I'm hungry. I'm not satisfied. God, I want you to move in me. God, I want revelation. I want to know. I want another dimension. God, I want to see people saved. I want disciples. But is God saying, will you let me take you to a place you've never been? Was slavery the only way God could get Joseph to Egypt? Father's favorite. Coat of many colors. Life is good. I'm happy. I'm sad. Is that you, disciple? Pastor? Oh, I got a good job. Good church. I got favor. I got ministry. Life is good. Joseph saved a nation, but it took slavery to position him in a region beyond. What about you? What does God have to bring to your door to shake you? Then there's Moses, living with a failure, 40 years, backside of the desert, 80 years old. God, don't bother me. I'm too old, or I'm too young. We have all of our excuses, and they sound so reasonable. I've married a wife. I can't come. Bought a piece of property. I can't come. 5 yoke of oxen. Lord, let's have some wisdom here. I tried that 40 years ago. And the burning bush in God speaking. Those powerful words, come now, therefore, to land. I will send you. Can I say, don't die on the backside of God's destiny, calling it the good life? Moses gives all of these excuses. Well, what about this and that and on and on and on? But watch the dimension of God. What's in your hand? It's a rod. Maybe it's been in Moses' hand for 40 years. We don't know. It's a stick. It's a tool. Every shepherd had a rod. It's common. Nothing special. Been in your hand for years. What's been in your hand, maybe? Ministry, preaching, Word of God. Something that hasn't maybe been all that impressive, but now God says, listen, throw it down. That rod became an instrument of deliverance. That rod brought plagues, turned water into blood, parted the Red Sea, water from a rock, and the list goes on and on. What's in your hand that will never see the potential of God unless you allow God to call you and send you to a place and a dimension you've never lived in? What's your region beyond? What about you? See, when you obey God, there's dimensions that kick in. Instruments of deliverance. Words that maybe you've spoken many times. When you step in obedience and faith to this place, it's beyond. Now those same words set people free. Those same words see people delivered, see them healed, curses broken. Think even here tonight. Tom Paine, would he be where he's at tonight if years ago he hadn't said, okay, I'll go to Nairobi, Kenya. Preaching Thursday evening. I'll go to Australia. Mark Olson, the Philippines. Alvin Smith, Sierra Leone. And I could go on and on. Paul Stevens, the Jeff Days, John McCarthy's, and the Pastor Warner in a wheelchair. I'll go to a place, Tucson. My point is, you never know what's way. It's only discovered when you live it. Would there even be an India if Connie and I hadn't said we'll go to Malaysia? In Malaysia, I had a burden. In Malaysia, I met Mike White. I believe it was 84. Created a business. Opened a door. Today there's 44 churches in India. My point is, what's waiting for you that you'll never find, you'll never discover where you are? There's nothing in all of life like going. Told Pastor Tory when he and his family went to Barbados, I said, my experience, Connie and I today, many years now passed, but our life is like before Malaysia and after Malaysia. It's almost like before Christ and after Christ. AD, before. It changed me. Would I be standing here tonight? I doubt it. If there hadn't been that time, God dealt with me. And you launched Connie and I. Go into all the world and preach the gospel. Our text, go therefore and make disciples of all nations. This is why you're going. This is what I want you to do when you get there. I commission you to preach and make disciples. I'm talking about shaping men, about forming involvement, hands-on. Is that your heart? Is that what you're doing? Is that what's in your mind? God, give me men. Help me, God. Help me to impart to them who we are. Help me to impact another generation. God, give me a word. Make me an example. There's something in me that stirs them to forsake all and follow you. Is that your dream? Is that your vision? Does it consume you? Because it'll cost you your life. Will you sacrifice your own desires, your time, time with family, time doing things you would enjoy doing? Because it's possible to pastor, yet not make disciples. It's more than just a sermon or a class. It's an impartation of life, where something is communicated that shakes them beyond who they are and where they are, into a dimension of God, where God now becomes the most important thing in all of life. More important than career, more important than security, more important than money, more important than this and that and all the things. God. You know, I wish I was young again. I know I feel young right now, but just to go. Go places. I go preaching places. I say, God, I would love to live here. Oh, the people, the masses, the humanity, the broken lives, the emptiness. Pastor Greg, the multitudes last night talking about people just like you and I. We heard even today, sheep that have no shepherd. Problem, if it's not in you, how can you put it in them? Paul said, I'll very gladly spend and be spent for your souls. I'll mortgage my life for you. The destiny, the DNA of our fellowship lives here. Will you allow your pastor to disciple you? Will you give him that liberty? I'm not talking about manipulation and all that, but will you let him speak to you in a real world? Theme of our conference in a couple months, discipling men in a virtual world. I'm talking about a real world. Not an imagined world. Not a fake world, but a real world where you can have a real conversation about real issues of life and heart and character, time and money, marriage, serving, sacrifice, discipleship. You watch me. You help me, I help you. I watch you, then I launch you. Time I mentioned when Pastor Olson and I was at the altar, Pastor Greg, I believe it alluded to it tonight, maybe Pastor Ruby, everybody was going. Everybody was talking about going. All this good-sized crowd here tonight, over 3,000 people probably. Wonder how many hundreds and hundreds and hundreds. Are you a candidate? Have you prayed those words, God, here am I, send me? There are dimensions of God you'll never experience. You'll never know. Till you go. I don't want to get to eternity and God perhaps show me what might have been. I want to get to eternity and Pastor Campbell say, Camel? Pastor Mitchell say, Camel? What were you doing? We're living in a time and an hour. I said this a number of years ago. I believe God has positioned this fellowship, Christian Fellowship Ministries, for a last day powerful move of God. Will you live it? Will you experience it? Will you be in the thrust of it? I ask you to bow your head with me this evening. You're here tonight and you're a visitor, you've driven up, or maybe you're a church kid, maybe you're sponsored. But sin is such a horrible thing. Sin is so wicked and so deceiving. You're here this evening. You need to be saved. You need to be born again. You need to have a personal born again experience where sin is forgiven, the curse broken, where you can be forgiven and free. What does God have for you that lives behind a prayer at this altar? Prayer, God, I'm sorry. I have sinned. Forgive me. I'm not right. Torments me.
Listen to the PHSA Potter's House Salmon Arm podcast. Be sure to follow us on Instagram at Potter's House_Salmon Arm to keep up to date on what we are doing, join the conversation, and discover how Jesus Christ can revolutionize your life.